We're live.
You okay?
Yes.
Thanks so much, Sam, for being here today for us, also for the internet, as well as everybody. First of all, I just want to say, we're on the conceded Coast Salish territory, as well as from Camosun's territory, as well. They've been so generous to volunteer the space for us on a continuing basis. We're also partnered with Courtland, University of Vancouver as well, where we'll be doing a panel on Wednesday night. Catch my breath. First of all, I got Rob Laurie to my right. Rob is a lawyer, Oxford-educated lawyer, very experienced in the cannabis industry. He's currently working on a test case before the Supreme Court. And he's going to tell us a bit more about that tonight. There's him and some people that we're going to come by. And there's our left is George Anstey, the crafts.
That's my context. Rob comes from sort of the more consumer-facing concerns and problem solving. I come from the back-end production concerns and efficiencies, and sort of where my mind is most today. So, know all about the ups and downs, the idiosyncrasies of application.
And we'll just go back to Rob in a second, but really quickly, what is Craft Depot?
Craft Depot is all about empowering market producers so that they can transition to the market and not just survive but really thrive and do better than they've ever done before. Sounds crazy, but should be
And Rob, tell us maybe a little bit more about how you came to be working in the cannabis space and sort of what your big interests are right now.
Sure. Well, I'm a lawyer, so I focus on the white market, and fortunately with regards to medical access at the moment, there isn't. Somewhat reliable supply, but most people were happy to go back to alternative or black market sources in order to access medicine. Looking post-legalization, we'll certainly get more into this, the theme though is that legal patients, despite best efforts, cannot access medicinal cannabis through the Health Canada License Producer Program. So ultimately, that's where I see what I'm doing is representing interests of patients, dispensary operators, licensed producers, as well as safe consumption lounges, because really these are the issues that I believe have chartered traction through Section 7. And I had to talk to these growers, cultivators. Because transitioning from the market that has been presented to us by the federal government, I think has wrought with failures and problems. And so for what George has been able to do with helping people transition into that market is fabulous. Where I come and my interest in this is great, you can get a license to produce cannabis on your way. But I still, for me, my interest is really looking at folks like Ted Smith and others like Judith who've been in this place for a long time advocating. facilitate to a legal market. Well, what that legal market looks like now, I hope looks a lot different in 6 months or a year from now or however we progress through our testing. So ultimately, I want to be clear with this room and those watching in BCICA TV here that, look, I'm for the industry, I am for the community, but most importantly, I'm for standing up for the charter rights of medical access, because if we get that right and we're able to get proper access from the federal government down to the provincial government, who can then, through delegated legislature or legislation to the municipality, put in proper zoning, licensing, and regulations so that we can get the best out of this. And so, I mean, you remind me a lot of Travis Lane in some respects.
Yes.
Travis has had the same story to some extent, that operating in one space and transitioning into another. But for me as the lawyer, I've always been in the legal space. Like, I don't represent clients. I mean, if they're breaking the law, that's their choice. But for me as the counsel and the advocate, it's to go to the courts and essentially say, how can what these people who are providing medical access like Ted, how can what they're doing be wrong? Provided Ted is providing access to patients in a way that is reasonable, dignified, if he's not gouging, if he's providing a clean, safe product and items, such as edibles and concentrates and derivative products, for example, that patients can't access now even if they want to under the legal framework, I still think that's where the rubber's going to hit the road in the next few weeks to months. Because I truly, despite best efforts of all involved, there's a disconnect between what needs to happen and what is happening.
So, you use two words that I've heard today in describing the legalization process so far in BC.
It had something to do with a show and shit.
Shit show.
Well, yes, and that's not the fault of any particular group in this industry. I mean, I think LPs are getting a lot of flack. And fair enough, they have to play by these terrible rules that groups that represent their interests are lobbying for. But actually, this patient crisis recently has allowed me to bridge some of the gap in terms of where people think I might be very hawkish about LPs and commercial corporate business in this space. The only reason I say that is because that's sort of also a background that comes. But ultimately, what we need to see addressed is how are we going to overcome this deficit of patient access? Because if LPs are allowed to produce in a way that licensing and access makes sense, they win. And that's enabled me to speak with folks like Dan Gould, who was at CBC this past 2 weeks. I mean, he works for an LP, but he can't even access the product that he needs for his condition. So I've asked him to be an affidavit of our testimony.
So that actually kind of plays in something that I saw when I was working for license producers. And there, within the law, within Canada, there is an obligation for our medical provisions to essentially guarantee access to someone's medicine. Like, if someone can't access their medicine, something has to change to allow that to happen. So there's this obligated mechanism where if you need to be able to access it, you're supposed to be able to get it, but it puts the onus on the person to go and find it. I think that there's a misnomer of corollary on the other side where they say, well, okay, if this person has a right to access it, there's then a corollary obligation of us as a society to make sure that that's provided for them. And so I think that there might be a really easy solution here. I don't know if it might already exist, but I feel that, like, and this is a feeling, like, I'm not a lawyer, I might be able to describe it better from a legal standpoint, but if a medical provider was providing something, and then there was a market that was found that was, let's say, in another country, as a private operator, they're well within their right to take that part of our CPC.
Of course.
And so long as we have a healthy, efficient market, another producer could come in there and there'd be no problem. And I think this is sort of the idealized environment that we have in our head when we're making the rules for how
But the point is, though, when you have the government that says you can only access your cannabis from this mechanism, which at the moment there's no, and I'm not saying that licensed producers, it's not your problem. You aren't being told you have to provide medical access. You're part of, initially, a medical access strategy, which through whatever fault or reason of the government, they've decided to leave how it is and go forward with a recreational market, which really helps us actually in court. And I agree with what you're saying. The problem is that until they remedy that defect, and the LPs themselves aren't going to do that when there's an incentive, the government has to come up with it. Because we have to remember that where we are now is not where Bruce Linton and these other characters wanted us to be a few years ago. They wanted the MMPR, they wanted 100% monopoly production. So for them, they're already producing cannabis despite how big they are. Mm-hmm. I think on metrics which they may or may not realize. And so whether or not you agree with opening up and liberalizing access for patients, I truly can see how larger licensed producers who've invested heavily into a distribution avenue that might very well get 100% diluted by the creation of a storefront medical retail access.
Yeah.
Now, whether or not there's supply or ample or adequate supply from the licensed producers ultimately comes down to how many licenses Health Canada issue, and if they don't issue enough and if it's too difficult to access, I remain and very confident that there will, in this day and age, in the product of cannabis, flower at the very least, you'll be able to access it at so many other points that it may or may not be worthwhile.
So let's talk about where we are right now.
Sure.
So I think a lot of us know about the recreational scene in BC, or lack thereof right now. We have two stores open, one in Kamloops and one in Kimberley. Kimberley.
One's private and one's government.
Yeah, I'm not sure if the Kimberley store is actually open at this point. I know they're licensed, but I don't know if they're open.
Yeah. Well, that's my mind about that.
So things are not good on the recreational side. It won't be for at least a couple more months, if not at least a year or two. But what's happened with medical patients right now? If somebody has a prescription and they've gone to place an order, what's happening with them?
Any medical patients in the audience? Okay, you registered with ACMPR?
Yeah, well, my sister is.
Can I just answer this question? Are you registered with ACMPR? You said yes.
My house is, yes.
Have you bought from an NLP?
No, my sister does.
Okay, we're just going to talk to her then.
Okay.
All right, well, anyway, that's good. We got some medical patients. None of you are registered, it seems, and are buying cannabis from the legal cannabis provider, correct?
There we go.
Yeah. So that, for me, illustrates in a room here of some pretty seasoned folks, and most of you are recognized or seen around at events, they're all having to go to the alternative market. And right, wrong, or indifferent, that is the Achilles heel that will now allow, like John Conover and the team that we're working with, Jack Lloyd and Dean Davison's lawyer, or sorry, Conover's lawyer, Dean Davison, because ultimately it will be that government failure or barriers that they put in place between medical patient and then access. Mm-hmm. And we argued under, in the test case before the Chief Justice, of like, point to me to another example of a medicine or a product or a pharmaceutical or a prosthetic even, that we don't access from a brick and mortar retail store. Everything underneath food and drug.
Yeah. It doesn't pass the reasonable.
So this is where I think, regardless of what legalization looks like now, something will have to give, because as John Conrad likes to say, the patients are voting with their feet. Now, the licensed producers, they have good people who grow big cannabis, and they got you helping and teaching them with the transition. And I truly believe when the government and Health Canada take their foot off your throats and actually allow you to probably produce something in a way that you're more...
I should probably say that. I think in a lot of ways that actually happened several months ago, at least on the production. And I think that the government world, the starting to see supply chains. We're starting to see restructuring of supply chains in the black market. And prices and availability are going silly. You know, like prices are starting to go up, but availability is going down. And
on the legal market?
On the illegal market, at least, and trying to keep up to date with it at least. So it seems as though while there's incredible incentive to transition, there's also a short-term incentive to not transition because of the opportunity of chaos in wholesale markets. And so it's left a lot of growers that were really seriously considering transitioning with mixed messages, you know, because so far, judgment basically hasn't been. There's a whole host of reasons for that data. But yeah, it is a symptom.
Who gets the legislation delegated from the federal government, which you can't just have a municipality going rogue like they have. So we responded saying, look, how you're regulating is illegal. The fact also that you're charging clients bylaw fines and all these other things, they just did a pro forma letter that the clients then disputed every ticket that they had come to them. They saw on the ground that the city of Vancouver has no legality to be licensing something that they are doing. Now, in the event that you can argue that, well, no, City of Vancouver will say, we are authorized under the Vancouver Charter to deal with business licensing issues and land use issues. That's fine. But the minute that they started regulating in a way that clearly created fetters and barriers to access, then we have a problem. And so that's at that point, we put the city on notice, file a challenge, and under a charter challenge test case, anything involving constitutional issues, so we said that what the city was doing fell afoul from Section 2 of the Charter, which is life, liberty, security, Section 2 is freedom of expression. Section 7, life, liberty, security of the person. Section 15, equality. Those are the charter grounds that we raise, and if you bring a charter case or a constitutional question under the Constitutional Questions Act, you have to then serve the Attorney General of Canada and the Attorney General of British Columbia. While both the Attorney General of BC and Canada participated in our case, and so we decided to set dates for our hearing, which were set for, well, starting September the 7th, and we wanted to go to court to adjourn in August, basically to say that now we have BC law and new federal law. Our pleadings were done under the ACM. That makes sense. So, you know, we were going to court on matters that soon were to be redundant with the Cannabis Act replacing the ACMPR. The good news there is the ACMPR and the Cannabis Act make no provision for any form of retail, storefront, brick-and-mortar access to cannabis. So that's how we were able to now bring arguments against the federal government and against the city of Vancouver with kind of the BC government in the middle. The nice thing about that was the city of Vancouver only were objecting to two or a disability for two of our experts, and the federal crown argued that we did not have standing for dispensaries to bring a case in the manner that we did. So we ended up getting an order and a judgment in favor of private interest and public interest standing. Because James McManus, one of our dispensary clients, was registered under the ACMPR, that meant he had standing to then challenge the ACMPR. But because he's also a dispensary owner and runs a dispensary, and the fact that the city sued the dispensaries and the landlords, that gave the landlords and the dispensaries, we argued, public interest standing. Plus, we had a whole bunch of case law that the Chief Justice had decided dealing with downtown sex workers, where we just kind of swapped the analogy from not-for-profit sex worker, not-for-profit foundation, and sex workers being like patients going to dispensaries. We just swapped out that analogy before the Chief Justice on the same case that he decided, and he couldn't rule against us, so we got standing on that. We then were able, we made it through where we could argue our charter argument. So we were able to prove there was an established charter right, Section 7. We were able to show that the government has infringed that right. We were able to show that, well, due to the lack of medical access and the fact that the government has only allowed for access through mail order, you know, delivery system, which isn't working, that then enabled us to essentially get a reserve judgment for the Chief Justice, whereby we have no idea how he's going to rule. All we know is he's got to reconcile city going rogue and licensing something that has no jurisdiction to do so, which means it's ultra vires. So we'll see how they reconcile that with the federal government, who's provided access by any way other, by every which way but one that makes sense. So something folks has got to give. Now, a reserve judgment and a test case basically means when there's an interest or a matter of constitutional importance, like abortion, or, you know, this, or firearms reference on that, or anything to do with, say, constitutional standing. If there is a matter and there you can pass essentially a test whereby this is of importance to the population because there's a pressing social, political, or legal issue, which, let's face it, patient access is massive. We were able to successfully get before the Chief Justice. Now, while he's still out with his reserve judgment, John Connery and I, about 3 weeks ago, started noticing, right, that these patients are now back to where we were with RV Parker, where, again, I'm harping on by trying to find these elusive people that are actually registered to the ACMPR and buying weed from an LP. Why? Because I'll bet you dollars to donuts that in the last 3 weeks following legalization, they've been able to get this much under the legal medical program. I'm selling my ship to Australia, Israel, wherever, because for right now, I have no obligation to provide to medical patients if I'm a licensed producer. I didn't set up my business to provide medical access, but the government created a system through licensed producers that was supposed to facilitate medical access. So that's where we're at right now, is despite, you know, the best efforts of a lot of sophisticated, intelligent entrepreneurs and captains of industry who are utilizing folks like George to get into this market, despite all of that good work, what incentive or what, you know, other than the goodness of their heart, should they be saying, we have that obligation? What? That's where we're fighting as lawyers and saying, no, 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 regardless of the legal system as it is, like people ask me, what do I think of it? I think it's terrible, and I'm doing my very best to destroy it by going for patient access. Why? Because if we get that right, then the LPs and the growers and the entrepreneurs and the businesses that are meant to survive will, right? But at the moment, we don't owe anyone this artificial system that's designed to fail, which just because some fat cats drop so many millions of dollars into a licensing process, it's been a failure. Like, you know, don't get mad at me. Get mad at the federal government. I'm only standing up to advocate, though, for the clear group of people that at the end of the day, regardless of what marketing campaign or strategy or you sell to, that's going to get us to the high ground first. We win that argument. And I said this to Bruce Linton the other day when I met him in Florida. Actually, no, in Las Vegas. I went up and I introduced myself, and I was like, you know who I am from the test case. And I said to him, look, you and the rest of these big LPs better start getting on the bandwagon of real patient access. Because if you don't, people will continue to vote for their feet, we'll get our judgment in court, and that marker that you thought you had on lockdown in the MMPR has now been kicked even further away from that, from the ACMPR and the Cannabis Act to now, some of those big guys may just die on the vine. We need to work together as the iron.
Yeah, well, we do, but a lot of this, the export market that is being serviced right now by Canadian producers is actually going to other healthcare systems, like one system buyer, like in case of Germany, the buyer in almost all the cases I'm aware of ultimately is the government. So we have the case that...
You know why they're doing that? I was in Berlin, and I talked to all these growers, and we're not producing it, but we're importing it from a legal producer. They're waiting to see because that doesn't give them any real trouble under international law.
Exactly.
They can blame Canada,
exactly.
Just like the songs.
We'll let them.
Right?
We'll let them.
Just like the same thing in Germany and in Australia. You love this. I was in a commune, Nimbin, right? The last bus stop before you're completely off-grid in the counterculture. And a couple of these like old haired kind of, you know, girls like, hey, what's it like in Nanaimo? And I'm like, well, why do you want to know about Nanaimo? I'm like, chill right, Sam. And I'm like, well, look around you. I'm seeing mangoes, guavas, pineapples, and, you know, lush green vegetation as far as I can see. And I'm like, you can't grow this outside in Nanaimo, right? And so this is ultimately, I feel that so what? Great, you're servicing, or not you, but LPs are servicing markets that, if they're smart, they'll realize they're bringing sand to the beach, which is what I said in Nimbin, that, I mean, Australia should be growing their own. You've got wonderful outback conditions for curing. You've got lush jungles for amazing indoor, outdoor, and whatever. And talk to Andrew Camosun there. But again, we're not seeing the best of this industry. I mean, we're seeing you transitioning into a box that, if we're up to me, it'd be a better box. It would be a Ferrari.
I think
that would allow you to be doing what you need to do efficiently in this market. But again,
perfect.
You can't because the government has put in a process that
perfect is the
limited.
Enemy of good. And you're not going to do anything like that. You have to take it considerably to achieve things that are meaningful most of the time.
I agree.
So I'm willing to take an imperfect system and fix it as I go. I understand the criticism. I actually hold a lot of the same principles myself, so pretty much on the same page.
But can I make a very simple illustration that supports transition. And I mean, that's a perfect place for someone who has come from the black market. You need to transition into that market in a way that works for you. I said to John Conroy, I'm traditionally trained as a corporate finance lawyer in England. I have a background in securities fraud. I still am legal counsel with the record of the largest historic securities fraud case in BC. It's like, I'm already transitioned to like the legal market. I had to go back to learn about patience and actually what growing cannabis looks like in order to be able to now come back and explain this message. So you and I have kind of been like Siddhartha. We've done our respective quests and we're now back to this position where really all we're fighting for is it goes back to this line of reasonable, dignified patient access, which started in R.V. Parker, that the government is just keeps having to be frog marched. So I agree it's not perfect. It's better to have something that isn't. But as I see it, we have been trying to get the government to implement reasonable, fair, patient access since the Parker case. Because just like Parker, who had epilepsy and had to grow his own medicine because there was no license for it, he was in the position of, do I grow my medicine and break the law? Or do I follow the law like a good citizen, not break the law, but yet not access my medicine? And so that's what we're faced with now, that, you know, I got no beef with the LPs, but there's a problem with the ability of a medical patient licensed under the legal Health Canada system accessing that product.
Yeah.
So that's where my beef is, not with those who want to go and work and do this or that.
My point about the German export market system is ironic that that country's patient access is now removing and will continue to remove the Canadian patient access to yourself.
But I see for now that only being a problem until they start figuring out their own. Because I can assure you what I find so ironic about Canada, here we are, a colonial nation, got our independence supposedly in 82, but yet we're selling off, and this isn't just cannabis, but all of our raw materials, our precious minerals.
We do like to do that.
And we sell it away to somebody that's going to then turn it into something and sell it back to us. Did we not learn anything about colonialism and tribal trade? Because again, it seems like Canada is now shipping away something which another commodity or country.
I think the difference there is that we're going to get concentrated.
What are you selling for? Give me an idea.
We're going to see wholesale prices overseas exceed $1 now in some cases, and maybe continue.
That's what they are currently in Ontario.
Well, that's retail. That's retail.
Okay, let's make a distinction there, because I've had chats with CEOs of LPs, and they're like, well, there's no shortage. You just go and get rec. And I'm like, I'm not arguing that. So you got to realize that rec access is great for what it is. That's a milestone in itself. But yet, for medical patients, I mean, I've been taking Ritalin from the age of 4. As far as I've been concerned, it's always been subsidized, it's been a DIN number and a process for which to access. Mm-hmm. But with the context, I look at cannabis and how, as a medical patient, I've been able to access that. So that particular commodity, I'm like, something is wrong and broken. So that's really, for me, is to see the process get tweaked out better so that you guys can serve the market better. Whether that's a German market or the Canadian medical market, that's an issue to be decided by Canadian legislators.
Do you see an opportunity for integrating some sort of provincial subsidy for those that are low income so that you can actually access things that would otherwise be sold at a market rate? Like, is there a precedent or is there even like a more hope for that?
I'm not paying full value. Market price for my Ritalin. I never have when I was a student.
Well, that's my point. That's why
I think the medical system has to be essentially LPs, whether, and again, maybe if it's not Canadian LPs, and maybe we're getting it all from the same growers that would be supplying Kirkland, who basically sources for Costco in the States, which, you know what, if that meets a medical standard, and let's just forget who's producing it. Let's just look at the premise that what is produced, first of all, will be suitable for a medical purpose. Because not your cannabis, per se, but I've heard that a lot of what is getting to the medical For now.
The big, like, probably one of the top three factors for that was the incredible in genetics that was available in the wheat market. And there's up until very recently, and it has changed, there was no ability to transfer genetics into a licensed environment. Now, with every new cannabis production license, you can transfer in any genetics that you want, provided that you declare. And if what matches in your facility is what is declared on your application, it's good to go. And so that's fundamentally changed, and I think we're going to see just an incredible growth in types of products that are available in the white market. And we're going to see things that really do provide medical treatment to people that need it. I think we've passed an inflection point where we're going to see huge diversity.
I couldn't agree with you more, because what LPs and the larger corporate entities do have going for them. I mean, ultimately, this is why we need to see rules and regulations that make sense, because, like it or not, they are the ones that will have the ability, working in conjunction with other multinationals and others, because I truly believe that we're not even where cannabis is as effective as what it can be. When you get down to that molecular level, we all basically know we have an endocannabinoid system. Yours is different than yours and mine, right? We're all going to need different ratio of CBD and THC depending on what the conditions are. The first versus preventative versus curing or treating an ailment. Ultimately, I think that science is going to be led by people with access to labs who get access to studies and funding and grants, because I truly believe that cannabis, if ingested properly, is essentially just giving your body what you need before it spins out of control and you get sick. I mean, we're just giving our bodies what we were giving all up until the last 93 years. But, an interesting argument where people argue is, well, you can only grow cannabis indoors in these controlled environments. And that's a cultivar. Well, I agree, expensive to cultivar, but, I'm going to Peru in January. I've been invited by Dennis McKenna. And I kind of looked at it with all...
Jealous. That sounds like a pretty good time.
Be very cool. But you sort of looked at it where, like, Terrence McKenna and these other ethnobotanists that were going out to discover all these different sacred plant medicines. Well, who were they learning from beyond Richard Evans Schultes at Harvard? But they had to actually learn from the Obispo or the indigenous people who, as far as I'm concerned, none of them have had labs or, fancy abilities to grow and understand. Data points is a different issue. But that's where I think with cannabis, is that type of degree in study is going to take the smoking and vaping to another level. But with regards to being able to access simple medicines and oil and the like, that is something that the government needs to figure out, and they won't be able to reconcile access that I want to see and that you and the world know that we should be seeing, because they have done it in a way that has to do with issues that have nothing to do with the goals and aspirations of the government. We're hoping to make our community safer. Well, we already know, at least Judith Stamps has written multiple papers on how cannabis improves communities. So I don't need to be of the government telling me about that. The black market, well, I think this is something the government has been a little bit cavalier about. Because if you do things in a way that alienate folks doctor's recommendation, then they come back with a bogus or a legitimate claim to access that medicine. My feeling is, well, they're just going to go back to the mothership and say, yeah, let's go hit the 10 other dispensaries that aren't providing access, that are selling bare rat and doing it in a bad way,
yeah,
and leave the ones that are providing some form of access. Because I still think that now, maybe why some folks haven't jumped in and embraced the white market is because it's impossible for them to actually transition.
I think that's a fair criticism.
And so I think that instead of the government trying to patch over the black market, I mean, that worked well for a biker gang the last time they were patched over. Usually there's some animosity. But if you incorporated the black market and set fair criteria, I mean, you come from the black market, let's agree that there are, I think, fair criteria that can be established to achieve the same aims of the government, without excluding all of these folks that really got us here.
That's the core tenet of resistance.
And that's why I'm pushing as hard as I can, because if I figure that we can get and crack this beast with at least the patient access side of it, well, patients, right, have to access edibles, tinctures, balms, salves, concentrates, derivatives, all of these things they can. And then look at Haley Rose, right?
Yeah.
Haley Rose is an interesting situation that she clearly is a medical patient. She is signed up to ACMPR, but get this, the oil/concentrate hybrid that she takes, no LPs can sell that.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, what is she to do? Just sign up to an LP and buy weed and oil that doesn't work for her so that she can say she's legal? And that's why I've been kind of fighting with the test case team, saying, no, we need to have Haley an affidavit, because what if someone in that case whose mother has flipped over every stone possible in trying to access this product legally for her daughter over the last 15 to 20 years,
yes,
who now we have legalization, but she can't even get the product, just like Daniel Gould, who that individual I mentioned that was featured in the CBC. So I said to him, look, dude, I got no beef that you work for an LP. That's awesome. Good for you. And the fact that your LP has supported you to make public statements that you can't access this, I said, look, I can't ask or want you to say anything more. So this is why, ultimately, I think that the 95% of the LPs who are not Canopy, Aurora, Sweetie, or Afria, or whoever, these are the ones that need to say, you know what, if we got behind and funded and stood up more for patient access that is sensible, mm-hmm, sure, that might cut into our initial bottom line because of this terrible monopoly that's been created. But I think by breaking that monopoly and bringing the right change and having LPs involved in this dialogue and actually forming their own lobby groups, mm-hmm, to see the lobby they want to see, as opposed to just relying on this other lobby groups that represent some LP interests, but not the majority.
Yeah.
We got to bridge that.
So I actually have a question kind of that sort of builds on some of the things you were saying earlier. With regards to the product categories that are presently not available, I think the oil category is all the high THC oils that are extracted with solids, typically. You can achieve high cannabis products using processing techniques or CO2, but most of the time we're talking about is some sort of hydrocarbon or alcohol extraction process. Do you think, because I've heard mixed information on this, do you think that patients really do have the freedom to go ahead and make those products for themselves? And if that is the case, I'd kind of like to hear your thoughts around what the solution is for the cannabis act that says that no persons are allowed to make those using their organic solvents.
Yeah, well, okay. If you're making it for yourself, really that's only going to get into an issue if you're busted. But again, what is the purpose of needing that solvent? If they're just saying you can't use BHO because there are some health concerns with it.
Well, I'd say it done correctly, there's no more.
Yeah.
In fact, if you're immunocompromised, for instance,
I would say you would
probably want a BHO.
Yeah. Now, arbitrary, or if they don't allow you to access it, like say a Section 57 exemption, given that you can show that, hey, I'm producing this in a lab, under these conditions, I'm a physicist, and I'm a chemist, and a QA guy, we're doing all of this, you know, best practice, then why not? Just because the government says you can't or can or cannot do so, you gotta look at the reasons why, and I think traditionally one of the reasons is that they've done it is, from the stupidity that I've seen is, you know, a lot of people that are making this stuff do it in a way that if it's done improperly, could very well blow up half the city block. And so part of me is in a way, well, I think that there should be provisions in place. But I've always felt with the growing cannabis and producing anything, why can't Camosun or Courtland, UBC, BCIT provide a course? You do the course, get the certification, and then you can be some quote-unquote licensed to then make, produce, or engage in these riskier activities. But that's the problem. We're coming out of this legalization where it's rec or med, and under med, well, an individual who's not selling to the public at large technically can produce cannabis in all of its forms. Thank you, Owen Smith, right?
Yeah,
but that changes then the context totally, that if now Courtland and I go into business and we want to start making BHO and sell it through a dispensary or online to medical patients, well, that's different. You know, we're not producing it for ourselves. We're now selling it beyond in a commercial. We're now duty of care, torts, negligence, and product liability litigation and all these fun things that the corporate legal markets just to get slapped up the head and all come into play. So ultimately, I think, why do we have government that's not facilitating access? That's the challenge. If they can facilitate greater access by lowering the standard of license or making it more accessible to do a course so that you can be certified to then have a license to grow weed inside or wherever, but because we don't have any of these certifications or recognitions or standards, we just have these hard and fast scenarios that may get you traction if you're a medical producer or a medical patient producing for yourself, which a private user would not be able to then make and sell and distribute out of the public large. Mm-hmm. So I guess ultimately is, what's the intention and purpose? If you're making it because without it, you can't function or it's life and death, or that you really can't maintain a job because you're not able to control the coughing or the seizures, then I would say that's a good instance to challenge that type of inadvertence.
Yes, I think that ultimately these problems are going to be solved. It's just going to be messy.
Well, that's totally it.
Well, yeah, so I think that's kind of the, you know, to sum it up, maybe before we get into some questions here.
That would be a lot. I'm confused.
Is that legalization 1 month in BC is not looking very good. Legally, recreational users can't find any legal cannabis. Medicinal users can't find their legal cannabis. We're all pretty much just going back to the black market.
I sure know I am. And Terry Booth and those guys in Denver literally had said that BC and Ontario shat the bed to a room of, you know, people that weren't too sure what to make of that. And so ultimately, that just shows what we're fighting, you know, with regards to access. When you have Terry Booth and these others that are now saying, well, the government's messing this all up, I feel vindicated because that's what I've been saying for the last 2.5
It is easy to criticize them. I'd say that we had an issue of timing working against us, and we had an issue of political power working against us provincially and municipally. So from a municipal standpoint, we, for the legalization implementation, unfortunately, was coinciding with all the provincial elections.
So that
made all municipalities unwilling to make decisions because, indeed, from the individual standpoint, they felt that by acting on this controversial item, they're then providing the fodder for their opponents to shoot them down and made very well the case.
Vancouver, I can say this now because they're out of the division party, but you know, Kirk and I went to the head of legal and said, you know, this 300 meters, if you drop the buffer down to 150, and just again, I didn't mention this earlier, but the 300 meters has nothing to do with best practice from Colorado or Washington State. what Vancouver said in all their marketing materials in that city or public hearing. No, the 300 meter rule of why that was adopted in Colorado and Washington. I know Ted's kind of sleepy. I explained this to him like months ago. But it has to do with the fact that those are federal criminal sentencing guidelines that Colorado and Washington had to essentially address that with dispensaries that were operating within 300 meters. Literally, the Attorney General for the state of Colorado, which was on our affidavit evidence from Josh Tappel, who him and Brian Vincente drafted Proposition 64, which basically the Attorney General could contact these dispensaries operating within 300 meters and say, look guys, you gotta move. We want you to move. Why? Because of these criminal federal sentencing guidelines that were designed at the height of the crack war in the 70s and, you know, in the most use in the 80s to create a separate offense with an enhanced penalty to dissuade people from dealing drugs like crack within 300 meters of a school. Well, if you're the city of Vancouver and your liquor licensing is 150 and yet you're you're now licensing cannabis because of all this medical access reasons and so on, why then would you have access to cannabis double that of alcohol when in their literature they're saying, well, people access cannabis as a harm substitute or, you know, opioid substitute or a substitute for more harmful drugs, i.e. alcohol. Which, so this is, again, why we attack these grounds. And we said to the people behind the scenes in the city of Vancouver, look, if you amend these bylaws to 150, pretty much all of our clients will have advised us to drop the case. Because most of them, if not all of them, would have been eligible for the zoning. However, they did it. And we said, look, if you do this, we'll drop the case against Vancouver and we'll sue Victoria. What did Victoria do? They increased the zone. And Victoria, just like Vancouver, it's no more legal for the city of Victoria to be licensing any of these guys as it is Vancouver. So we just argued before three levels of government, before the Chief Justices of BC, that, you know what, none of this is legal. But even if it is, and you claim that you're lawful under land use and business licenses, well, the way that you are doing it is creating barriers and fetters to what? Patient access, which means you're falling foul of the chucker. And until they get that right, that's just going to be the Achilles heel of the nuts that we keep picking on the government's beast. Until they get toward policies, rules, and regulations that actually facilitate reasonable access. R.V. Parker, the choice of his medicine, or breaking the law and going to jail. That's ultimately what we're faced here. And so I agree and concede that LPs, well, unless you've been lobbying the government to create the mousetrap this way, you have no incentive to change. But my feeling is there's more LPs out there getting screwed by these rules in place that would not lobby or would lobby against these rules if they had the organization and the mobilization to do so. Why? Because if you can produce a superior product at $600 a pound and the other guys are having to do it at $1,000, you're going to be sticking around a lot longer, at least be able to cushion some of these price fluctuations.
So, I mean, I think that the falling prices in the black market is not actually really affected at all in equipment. I think the two are somewhat inverse, even though the variables that create that inversion are somewhat separate.
Well, for a while, though, LP weed was cheaper than what you could get in the dispensary.
Yes.
You had
$5
to $7 grams, $7.5 grams, whereas for ease of convenience, most dispensaries, you're looking at a compassionate gram or Texada type or some good table medicine for $5 gram. But the really good stuff would be anywhere from 15 to 20. No, but that's just it. If it's a $20 gram under a microscope, and when I walk into dispensaries, legal or licensed, I usually don't say, you know, what's the most expensive.
No,
you've got a story that is particularly good at this point in time. Because that's just it. Ordering some weed or online on board without from the test case, we had Dr. Jakubas Zaburkas from the University of Houston, who was essentially like a molecular chemist. And he had explained to the Chief Justice what terpenes and terpenoids were. And system. If I'm a seasoned medical patient that again can pick up cannabis and go pinene, lenalol, lysine, whatever, and understand like through those terpenes and the terp profile, you know, whether that's all I need or not, but it's still something that informs your decision.
And now in BC they are going to allow sniff jars, which at least I think that's a meaningful.
It's better than nothing, but it's better than you know, how long has that sample been in there? Well, they sprayed the sample. They get into some brand.
It's under the shop room.
Sprinkle it with.
They're not obligated.
New car wheel.
They're not compelled to do anything. It would be up to them whether how often they want to
change
the sample. BC stores do have some jars, which I think is not cool. I think that's a good.
But again, let's ask ourselves, why do we need all these rules and regs when I look under my sink at home? And there's more, well, not anymore, because we put it in a safe spot, but legal things like dishwasher tablets and soaps and all these other things, certain foods, peanuts. I mean, come on. We don't regulate peanuts as hard as this, but we look at all these rules, and I guess, you know, I don't want people to think that I'm like this pessimist. I'm not. I'm the ultimate optimist, because, well, you know, who else is crazy enough to take on the government and hopefully win? But it's like, ultimately, we're trying to push for better rules and better regs that make sense. And if it's not this liberal government, Judith, and I apologize, Judith, if I was dismissive on that text when I said whatever, but I do kind of believe that we have an election coming up. I'm pissed off at Trudeau. He's at strike 7 in the meeting, not just on cannabis stuff. Whereas, well, maybe if we vote him out and the Conservatives get in, I mean, that's not what I'd like to see, but, you know, this is not necessarily conservative insiders who, with lobbying with MCAP partners and other big hedge funds, that have designed the system. I mean, fuck them, let them die on the vine for all I care. That system is not in our best interest. So if it means they die because of an election and they replace it with a new or a better system or something else, then I still think that is a great equalizer. Do we have to go that extreme? I hope not, but it seems like anything that's been sensible and we leave to the government to do the right thing, it's almost like they come up with a diametrically opposite conclusion. I'm getting tired of having government, I guess, piss on my leg and tell me it's grain when I know full well what it is. I mean, you know too.
Yeah,
we all know where it's for.
I think for whatever it's worth, though, I think you will win the constitutional challenge.
Thank you.
Medical distribution will
and then an LP can hopefully hire me and I can retire and ride off for the
I think the whole dichotomy of LP or
I gotta do my job first, then sell it.
Is actually not really the case anymore. Certainly there are very large cannabis companies that control large portions of the market right now. But the idea of it's LP or nothing is just simply not the case anymore.
Yeah.
There's 9 federal license categories where before there was 1 federal license category.
That's so going to make a huge difference.
So I think that a lot of the things that we're concerned about right now have already been addressed, but their effects haven't been seen because we're going through the administrative process of actually delivering what we want. And so I think criticizing the problems right now is certainly important. But I think that we need to make a distinction between the things that have already, or criticizing the things that have already been addressed, and the things that we need to criticize that have not yet been addressed. Which your constitutional challenge actually is one of those blind spots that has not been addressed. So I think that putting a lot of emphasis on the medical access route, specifically with dispensaries, is really a good use. Good focus. It's a good use of our efforts.
Just food for thought. It's very easy in like constitutional charter litigation or administrative litigation. And they teach it in the university, law school, that if you can get to the charter, do it. Because the administrative grant is all about high ground. And so unless, you know, my license to become an LP is refused on the grounds that I'm a Scientologist or I'm black or I'm a member of Jehovah's Witness or whatever, very big challenge because I was a liquor inspector that denied an applicant on the ground that he was a Jehovah's Witness or Christian Science.
For that's sure. Well, you have to understand that, but unless that's the case.
Exactly, but you know, if you're just operating a rec dispensary, just saying, you know, screw the government, screw the rules, and you're doing your own thing, you're going to get stopped.
Because
you don't have the charter.
Can you say that again?
Right, if you're going to operate an illegal business, right, the only thing that will possibly save you will be embracing the charter and going to the high ground, which is the charter access. If you don't do that and you're just going to continue to operate as a through-the-door recreational cannabis where we'll sell to anybody 19 or older, well, yeah, that is essentially right there. Where is your charter protection? Go ahead, Ted.
I got a question I would like to ask about those dispensaries continuing to operate illegally. I've had the government come after me for GST that I had not collected.
You're a special case, Ken, on so many fronts, but let's hear your question.
Well, my question is that there's a new sin tax that the government is charging on recreational cannabis.
Are you talking about the excise tax?
Yeah. Do you think that the government's going to retroactively go after those dispensaries operating
that's a great point. And I do think dispensaries have a lot to worry about in some respects, because if you have been providing medical access, okay, which is confirmation diagnosis with supplemental brands and so on, then I think you're operating in a way that the government hasn't recognized. So more power to you. That if you are busted for selling products that are on the no-fly list now, or that you're making cannabis accessible from a non-LP source that's not compatible, then provided you're doing what I said earlier, vetting the clients, you're ensuring that there are, you know, medical documentation, that's the only way you can ensure that an undercover who comes through the door at least is going to then be registered or declare that they have some form of condition or doctor's authorization or recommendation or confirmation of diagnosis, which might be just enough to be the difference between a criminal conviction or a successful charter challenge. So my advice is that if you've applied and you're trying to transition, if you can survive and that, you know, it'll all work out, great, do it. But in the last 2 weeks, I've had more clients who were planning to shut down, who did shut down, say, you know, forgive my language, their exact words, fuck this, I'm opening up again. Right? And my cautionary tale is that, well, if you do it, make sure that it's medical access, you require confirmation of diagnosis, the product is tested, it's clean, and if you're gouging customers, I don't want to represent you, or I don't want, you know, to be your counsel, because ultimately, the dispensaries that are meeting that criteria and are operating in a manner of access, then there's a charge of challenge. We can get to that and say, look, there's no provision for the storefront access under the ACMPR. It's specifically excluded. There's no mention of storefront retail access for medical under the Cannabis Act. It's specifically excluded. Why? Well, it doesn't matter why. We just have to show that the charter rights have been infringed, and it doesn't have to be the group or the majority. The nice thing about charter litigation, it could be that one unfortunate soul who's living on the street with a serious medical condition with no fixed address, whose only access to cannabis could be the compassion grant with the cash that he's been able to get from, you know, begging and donations, that they go into a place like Ted's or another dispensary for a compassionate grant. I mean, we argue before the Chief Justice of what are these people supposed to do, get a prepaid Visa card? Right? Like a homeless guy with no fixed address is going to, what, get...
That's unreasonable.
It totally is. And so that's where that, even if, you know, if it's that one person in our system who can't access it legally.
Yeah.
And that's where charter litigation, it just has to be that one silver bullet, right, for it to change the whole system. And so I really hope that when this case or we get a decision that's favorable and the government doesn't appeal,
what's the timeline for that?
It could be next tomorrow, it could be next month.
So what would
next year?
For specifically for the charter cases?
We don't know. A judge can take as long as necessary. that's where we've been collecting. You've probably seen some of my Facebook posts and John Conroy's that have been like reaching out to people saying, have you been having trouble accessing? Great, we've got about 10 affidavits at the moment with a few more coming in that just examine the same issue. Registered ACMPR patient, licensed or registered with an LP, able to get it some of the time before legalization, but they've been going to a dispensary after legalization. They can't access it from an LP, they have to go to the black market. So it's those affidavits, and we're bringing an application before the Chief Justice, hoping before Christmas break, so that he has to consider the exact problem we're in now.
Yep.
That is so this bad.
I have a practical question.
I want to make sure we answer Ted's question. Excise tax, should they be collected?
Not on medical access, but at the moment on this rec stuff in a government licensed store, fine. But for those that aren't there yet.
Didn't they throw the excise tax on top of the CMPR as of October 17th?
Yeah.
Yes, but that's different though from accessing under medical. And that's the problem. I mean, you can't get anything under the medical system. I, as a medical user, would have to go to the black market or go to a retail store, pay excise tax on that as well as a grossly inflated price, presuming they even have the strains of the products that work for them. So yeah, if they come to UTED and try to charge excise tax on a dispensary that's not applying for a legal license and that is continuing to stay open defiantly, providing the type of medical access I just described, then yeah, you should be worrying about excise tax. You should be more worried about getting arrested or raided by provincial enforcement, at which point, because they are a branch of government, that attracts charter. So for me, it's kind of like, who's going to draw blood first? And where are they going to do it? I mean, look, if I was the head of enforcement for the BC Liquor Control, and I thought of applying, actually. So I mean, like, I'd be pretty good at it, given, like, the experience. I couldn't speak at one of these events again. You just to put a contract out on me. But the point is that, I would go to Gravel Street and bust a whole bunch of dispensaries that day. I'd make it real big, high profile, tell the media, and have the RCMP come in with the permission of the VPD to bust all those like dispensaries that are the Wee Medicinals or the Lime Lifes that aren't providing medical access. They're hiding under medical access and literally just selling black market rec weed.
So
that's what I'd be busting.
That's actually a question.
Not you or the other like places that are doing this properly and have been for the last 20 years. You're going to keep having to do what you're doing in order for us to get a decision or a decision that challenges where we're at.
So let's assume that you do in this case, and I actually think you by the time that it's done, and let's assume these dispensaries still exist, hopefully they do well, where is the weakness coming on the shelf? Where is that going to be coming from?
Well, I agree, and that's where I'm explaining to clients, that's a different fight for a different day, but hang on, this is a question, but wait, there's more. The interim period that we'll be asking the Chief Justice to allow dispensaries to operate for maybe 6 months or a year or however long, until the government then comes back and says, you've remedied this problem with supply and so on. But until they do that, they're just going to end up licensing a dispensary who's going to be sitting there twiddling their thumbs, waiting for the retail product to come down, or the med product, which won't because it's all going to retail. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, the sooner they fix that and address that, then the sooner we can begin to actually hope that a government, whether it's a Trudeau government, which I doubt, because again, like this whole system that they've bought into is designed for a certain few, which again, I don't think they'll ever do anything, which is why maybe if the conservatives get in, my enemy's enemy is my friend, they can then go in with a proper audit and look at the liberal incentives. Now, they'll probably come up with their own system that'll benefit their interests, but as long as it addresses the patient issue, that's up to them. If they address that, fine, that's a win. If they don't, I know you're shaking your head, Judith.
They'll never address it because
Well, then I'll be never done.
Well, the Canadian medical
which is why if a government doesn't appeal it, the Chief Justice will then rule that the federal government will have to go back to design some form of access that works that will involve or utilize a form of retail, which means having to reconcile and address that issue of where does the supply come from? Well, the answer very clearly legally is from a licensed producer. But will that be the case in a year or 6 months? I don't know. All I can do is get the Chief Justice to agree with us that there is a an access issue under Section 7, which means that these rules and regs that have been put in place are incompatible with the Charter, and it's the government, not the courts or the lawyers, who then will say what the program will be. All it is the government have the ability to fuck it up the first time, or, you know, instead of, but, you know, hopefully they'll get it right. But that's why 20 whatever years later, from Parker to Allard or this test case 2.0, right, we're still trying to get toward this line of what fair, reasonable access looks like. But it's the government or the insiders or the folks that then come up with the policy that then rolls downhill to the provinces and the municipalities. That's only going to be as good as what they come up with. And what they've come up with all due respect, was designed not with patient access in mind. It was designed as a revenue-generating model for purposes that are noble. I mean, of course, we've got to pay for hospitals and bridges somewhere. But ultimately, if the folks that need it can't access it, then it's real easy. We got the high ground of the Charter. So why complicate it? If the government keeps leaving themselves open by not addressing the one area that they have to, then we'll keep exploiting that vulnerability.
But the problem is governments don't like to be told what to do.
Well, neither do medical patients, right?
No, they just don't like them, so they suck. They sell money.
But luckily we have a Charter that we don't have absolute rights in Canada, but we are able to demonstrate when the government goes beyond minimum impairment. And that, I think, is quite exciting because 2 or 3 weeks ago we had a case out of Mexico, a constitutional case where, yet this, ladies and gentlemen, it wasn't found unconstitutional in the context of medical. It was wrecked.
Yeah.
And they said that undue interference in the government, or, you know, government creating unnecessary barriers to accessing recreational cannabis was unconstitutional. And I'm looking at, wow, that's an erect context. Whereas, you know, we have established Charter case law from Parker all the way to Smith and Allard that guarantees this medical right that the government has, maybe they've been busy thinking about other stuff, but they have ignored it to the point that they can't ignore it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So,
anybody else? Anybody want to go?
Oh, no, I was going to throw it back to you to see if you had any thoughts about this transitionary mess that we're in.
Well, I've certainly got a couple of thoughts, I'll put it that way. I mean, are they good thoughts? Honestly, to me, it's more about Western independence and British Columbia's economic independence. You know, we have been constantly assailed by Ottawa on resource issues, and frankly, this to me is just really a resource issue.
Mm-hmm.
And now we've seen the government has come in, and whether they wanted to or not, I certainly don't think there was some grand conspiracy to steal the industry. There's certainly a lot of incompetence, and maybe some work, to do it, but certainly a lot of incompetence. I've shifted the balance of power in this industry to Ontario, and that really
that's
is
fine design.
Yeah, and that, I mean, it's shocking to me, and we're still watching it happen, and we're still not speaking up to protect ourselves as an industry in BC, as a community. We're just kind of watching it happen and going, ah, shit, government screw us again.
The BC NDPs, if they wanted to do something for British Columbia in this instance, well, they've done very little to say to Ottawa, why should they at the end of the day? Because fine, you could give the federal government medical and say, that's fine, you've got providence to medical access under Section 92. However, Section 92.13 these are our terms for recreational cannabis, what processing, distribution, and access looks like in BC. Because does Alberta contact the Ontario government and say, hi, we need another license for oil exploration, right?
Yeah.
I mean, cannabis is agriculture, which is a provincial traditional industry.
I think there's actually some benefits to having it federally administered.
Ooh.
No, I think there are some benefits. I think that right at the gate, the ability to operate without being encumbered by the provincial trade barriers is actually a net benefit for the operators. But I hear what you're saying.
You still have tons of barriers in the
The municipal lobbying, presumably, there's that. There's that as well. But
presumably, the municipalities aren't all bought up by LPs.
Well, they're not, though. So they're quite different from district to district.
Oh, right. it's a patchwork of difference.
So I think, I do hear what you're saying, and I agree in principle, and I agree in sentiment, that it's really unfortunate that BC is losing grip on something that it has had, and right up until quite recently, it's what propelled the economy in province, and I'm really fearful if we completely lose the ball. If we completely lose it, I'm very fearful for the rural economies in British Columbia. I'm not sure how that's going to go.
Well, that's just it. You know, you've got like Grand Forks, Nelson, places where at one time, Brian Taylor would stay in Grand Forks at 1 in 10 homes.
We were trying to find him in Grand Forks. We didn't find him.
He's the mayor now.
Well, I know.
The point is that, you know, a lot of these economies, I think you're going to have your legal on-grid weed with the barcode, tracking, and all that, which is fine, but I can't see how the Kootenays and Nelson and the Gulf Islands and Cobble Hill and all points in between, people are just going to wake up one day and go, you know what, I'm going to do something else. Because again, the people I know that grow weed every day don't give a shit about the stock price. They're going to get up tomorrow to grow weed because they like doing that. And they do it very well, which means they may stop when it's easier for them to get the good kind of cannabis they produce from somewhere else. But I think until that happens, you're going to see people jump ship who have the ability and want to, but I do think you're going to see continued polarization for a short period of time until the rules and the regs and the access is sensible. And for me, my own goal in all this is to see the best weed produced by people who know what they're doing, can bring it to market at a cheap, fair price, at consistent intervals, that ultimately I hope I can go to Costco and get a flatbed truck and just there's my bale of high-grade weed for the weekend, and I'm having people over, and that's great, but I mean...
I think that future's not far away.
Well, it is in Canada, because I go to the U.S., and I mean, here you can't get, Crown Royal Prairie Harvest because they only release so much of it. The Americans don't know what the hell it is, and it all collects dust on the shelves. So I think it's an exciting time whereby if we're not getting weed locally, it'll come from international. But even if it's coming international, will it even get into Canada without duties and imports and tariffs? Meaning that if we haven't remedied access and distribution, rec or med, we're still going to have a black market that will facilitate either or and have a charter behind if they can demonstrate that they're doing it in a way that isn't conforming to the charter, but at the same time, the government is just doing it in such a bad way, and that's why now we're going to go with an application to the government or to the Chief Justice now, as opposed to waiting until the government get it right, because I kind of feel like this is perfect.
Yeah.
The last 3 weeks, it couldn't be better. Like, literally catching the government with their pants down. Why do we want to go to court when they have time to put on belt and braces?
Yeah. Well, I think for the concerns that you have, like now...
For this fight, for
yeah,
now,
now
is
now
this.
Is
the next fight will be that same issue you pose, which is, fine, I'm a dispensary, I have a license, but where do I get my product?
Yeah, and I
don't know the answer to
that. I think that that's kind of getting more back into my realm of expertise.
Oh,
my realm of expertise is breaking down regulations in a practical sense, so like in key transparency in the very new black market, how to transition. And that's really been a core tenet of my mission is I'm not looking to change the way it's administered. I'm trying to find the most efficient way to work with what's right in front of me. And so we need to be friends so that I can feed you information about what's working and what's not working.
Why working together is so important, because at the end of the day, if we can't get medical access right, then I kind of see any of these other wonderful accomplishments in our industry are tarnished by that. It's like medical access should be like the equivalent in this industry of putting a person on the moon, right? Like if we can't get and produce medical access to people that need it, then we got to revisit, I think, the delivery of the system. And the quality of the product and the ability to get it to market, well, you guys have to only deal with what you're allowed to do. But it doesn't mean you shouldn't be lobbying or working together with us to figure out ways so we can get this change that we need happening faster.
Well, I think we see things on the margin somewhere as well.
I agree.
And that's the reason that we have a meeting and want to come together, is so that we all work from the same page and have the same information and support each other as opposed to being disparate actors working off of disparate information.
So with that in mind, say,
So,
just a comment before I have a question for both of you. So, number one, I think that we had a decent, although not perfect, access to medical before the record that can be debated, but it worked to some degree. And then, there's some comments made here that the LPs, big LPs, are somehow like favoring the rec market at the expense of the medical. I think that's true in some cases. If you look at how their sales model works, they sell direct to consumer on the medical side still. So there's higher profit margins to be made in the current existing medical market than there is in the rec market. So I think that's great because it prioritizes the medical side of the industry and patients. So what's confounded that is the provincial supply monopolies because from my understanding anyways, the LPs need to sell direct to the provincial redistributor, but the province has such a huge ability to negotiate because they're so big and they can pay so much. So I guess the contracts were set up that you need to provide what you signed up for right up at the start. So that kind of sucked all the supply right off the bat. And I think that the LPs they didn't want that. Nobody wanted that. That's the province's being greedy. And that's not my opinion. That's a lot of people share this opinion. I'm just kind of sharing it out for some context here. So I think that's where this. A lot of this contentiousness comes from is that the provinces were really a little bit overstepping their bounds in terms of kind of controlling this. Because I think the feds and the LPs were generally able to sort of supply a decent amount of medical.
I think he nailed it, just quite simply. You pretty much nailed it. You're kind of hitting a core tenet of what we've been rallying back and forth. Is that there isn't a federal obligation to actually look after medical patients at all, which
I was quite shocked that I found out actually when the Cannabis Act was first introduced. I was like, wait a minute, what happens to the medical patient?
It's just not addressed. It's just literally not addressed.
Yeah. And there was somebody who I know and like, and they were mostly sarcastically speaking at that very large LP here, and they said, fuck off, who cares? We'll go with the whatever province pays us.
I don't think that attitude is the reason. No. I think that I identify that right away. I think that really the reason is that it just wasn't addressed, and so it was sort of like the orphan child issue. I think it would be an awkward one to bring up within private industry circles without sort of a rallying. From people saying that this is important, this is important, this is important. Without us saying that, the corporate interests and the government regulator interests are going to choose the path that's convenient for them, because that's what humans do. And so we need to be diligent as participants in this market to really communicate where those blind spots are and everything that you described and do beginning with. Like, that's a spot.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. I do have a couple quick questions too. So, I guess I'll just to finish up what you're talking about there too. Two of the most famous committing to supplying the medical market as a priority, then that's good for the brand, right?
Yes.
So the market, like, we can talk all we want, that's going to help, but, like, fundamentally, like, if I'm buying rec, I want to go to a supplier that's providing medical as a priority, because A, it's probably good quality, and B, that's the moral, that's the more of the correct thing to be doing here.
Yeah.
So I support that as a consumer, but, as far as questions go for you guys, there's been a lot of criticism, right? So, I think, Rob, that's kind of your sort of your ballpark anyways. So I just like to ask you, what you would like to see in your perfect world, if you could succinctly summarize that, and then for George, like, maybe what are the things that you would like to see change, or what are the areas you're focusing on, because I know there's been a lot of change in the last 6 months with sort of your side, so what are you focused on?
So, I mean, I guess I have to distinguish between the things that I'm passionate about and the things I'm focusing on, because I'm really, really passionate about responsible production, and I'm really passionate about reducing the gross inequality that's just tearing into it will tear society apart. I'm going to just come and say that this will actually tear us apart. If we can't address inequality at a structural level, we're fucked. So, like, that is something I'm quite passionate about. What I'm focusing on for the time being is making light of this cup half full, you know? I'm trying my best to work with whatever is being given to me and sort of like call together like these business deals that are actually compliant for the first time ever. And it's amazing. Like it's really amazing to see international trade go through in a way that doesn't require satellite phones or, you know, having to use VPNs through the network or things like that. So you can just be a cannabis company and call up a company in another part of the world and say, hey, do you want to buy Canadian weed? And like that's never happened before. That's amazing. So for me, it's a cup half full. And I want to focus on the things that are working and double down, you know? And so I think this is like the dynamic between Rob and I is actually very interesting in that way, because he's focused on the things that aren't working and I'm focused on the things that are working. And it would, you know, and respect. Absolutely.
Well, respect to you and everything that you're doing. I mean, I sort of see it right now, but I'm really intrigued that, and I was, you know, a few years ago when Vancouver started regulating licensing, thought this is fantastic. I mean, dispensaries, they have such a role to play. I mean, when I went with, you know, with Jamie Shaw and Terry every neighborhood needs this. And so I'm so optimistic about here we have this municipality that's looking to really regulate for medical access. And, you know, I actually came to this fight really optimistic that the government was going to do this sensibly. And then I started learning about all this stuff about, you know, like the fears and the misinformation and the bullshit reasons, oh, you can't have a dispensary 300 meters from a school? I'm like, come on, like, who's buying that? Take a different road if it's such a problem, or like, you know, it's like, you look at the legal things that we have in our lives, like porn and alcohol and tobacco and all this other vice. Somewhat sensibly considered the risk and the dangers that they involve, but when it comes to cannabis, what's our default? Well, we try to regulate like alcohol and tobacco, which to me made no sense because those products, if used directly, will kill you. Cannabis, we still have a little bit, you know, there's the jury's out, so to speak, on the effectiveness, which...
As I said before, we have the difference.
Oh, I know you got that. I'm joking. I know the jury's damn well deliberated on the effectiveness of cannabis. It's just the problem that our government's at all levels, it seems, just at least for right at the moment, have been figuring out reasons to say no. It's easier to say no than it is to say, you know what, maybe we have an opportunity here to roll up our sleeves and get this right. And that's what I guess where my passions are, is coming up with solutions. I actually hate being a litigator because it's adversarial, it's confrontational. You don't build anything, you just fight. I mean, at the end of the day, I used to joke when I was a juror. your offense and the defense is then being able to come up and know how to bring good ideas to market. But the challenge for me is that because I understand and I love this industry, but I also understand finance and corporate world, that I just see how they're rolling it out is absolutely asinine. I mean, I've been saying for the last 3 to 4 years, like, this is going to be a failure, right? I felt like a first-class passenger on the Titanic yelling, iceberg, well, most of my friends are like, oh, no, the LPs will do the right things. And, you know, that's what bugs me about Hillary Black. I'll say this, like, I think she did a fabulous job 20 years ago, but I haven't really heard much out of her and a lot of the other activists that have gotten been a fight that it's the lawyers who have been backed by the dispensaries that believe in it. Mm-hmm. To be honest, no one believed we'd get this far. Right? Kirk left us a month and a half before trial. We had to bring in John Conroy, which I'm so glad I did because I learned so much under his mentorship and preparing for this test case that we didn't think we'd win it. But you know what? Sometimes when you're in a situation where you're not going to win and you just focus on the fundamentals, which are the charter, patient access, and then the failure of the government to deliver on that promise, that's all I got to show for now. And I hope that if I can play some fundamental change in the system and get it to a point where it's more accessible, then you know what? I can stop being the Johnny Cash man in black and maybe put on my Joseph Amazing Color, 10 Color, Dream Coat, and you know, start having that happier message. But unfortunately, the government that got us here has failed us in a very important aspect, and I think there's a tremendous opportunity that I encourage LPs to come and join us. And I support you, you support us, because ultimately we're supporting this deficiency of providing medicine to vulnerable people, right, who should be getting it for them. Then that's a win on any level, that I don't care who you are. That is a win for humanity and society because it's the right thing. And the government needs to be doing what I see as the right thing on a more regular basis. Too many scapegoats and buck passing.
Cheers to that.
So,
well,
any more questions?
It's just from the chat stream, there was one who said that tomorrow night, in Langford at the Sheraton Hotel.
Is that Patrick Bruckman?
That's Patrick.
That's Patrick.
Nope.
It's got Patrick.
Maybe.
Hey, yes. Go to the event.
It's, yeah, the,
we're
it's
coming.
I can't.
From 6 to 9 at the Sheraton Hotel in Langford.
It's at the Sheraton Hotel. So
you want to take
it? On teaching.
Yeah, so it's
has a free craft cannabis introduction teaching on how to get into micro licenses.
That's the next day.
Yeah, that's the next
that's
day.
That's where I'm going.
Yeah, I was on the call with Patrick coming out here, and because I was asking him, because your group and what Patrick's doing,
it's very similar. We
very similar.
Know, I wouldn't say in the same breath, our model is fundamentally different. We take an attach and hit approach with the micro cultivators, and we always work to amplify what they already have. Whereas, from what I understand, they're different approaches, and ultimately they're going to yield success either way you go. But I've got nothing but love to support those guys. So.
That's awesome. I mean, I do recommend that you do check out this event. I would be going to it because it's not far from where I'm over to live. But more importantly, I think, you know, other than litigation and advocacy and lobbying for the right changes, I think the craft market is where I really want BC to succeed. I think it's been the market where, hey, we are the craft market, whether they like it or not, and I'm hoping that our case will lead to the government at the federal level and the provincial level facilitating greater access and participation, because ultimately, I don't think we're seeing the best of the industry yet. I mean, we're doing the best of what we can, but I still think the best days for BC, if you know we can get this craft thing going, will be what differentiates our product from the rest of the country. Because I think we're the only one that can grow outside technically all year round.
Well, that's not even really the main trick of the city there. I'd say it's mostly a genetics question, it's a know-how question. You know, we've got the know-how of genetics and of culture that we push forward. And I think that, you know, where the legal market is right now is just scratching the surface of what's actually there. And we're going to see, though it's the newcomer, the craft cannabis is the newcomer, I think we're going to see it make waves internationally and for years to come. I think that it's going to occupy a much bigger portion of the market than it was expecting.
Just so we can access the craft product, because isn't that great? With international craft beer, I think yet you go to the BCLC.
And I think that is going to be the case. I mean, if you carry your load there, it's kind of outside of the city.
Well, you can. My door is open to you anytime, both of you, in order to reach me. And I mean, if there's questions from folks in the room, I mean, Judith contacts me a lot with questions. I love it. I love the banter and the dialogue that we have. She keeps me on my toes. Ted's an activist that I absolutely love, and I admire all the work that he's done to get here. And I mean, there's other folks in the room that, you know, I'd love to have you reach out and hear your stories, because ultimately, I don't have all the answers. I rely a lot of the time on folks who have their ear to the ground who relay a lot of information to me. And so ultimately, why I love what I do is I feel I'm part of a community, but I also want to feel part of an industry.
Totally.
And so that's where I feel that these dialogues tonight, we are bridging that gap between community and industry.
So just one closing thought. You know, if there's anyone out there that does have questions, they'll listen to me. Easily teach. So we're working on templates so that we can teach growers how to go through the licensing process themselves. It's kind of real adage, teaching them fish, giving them fish. So we've been giving out a lot of fish so to get people going, but ultimately it becomes a bandwidth question. So to address that bandwidth hurdle that we're approaching right now in the auditorium or leadership, we're creating templates for applications. So if you've got the will to go through the licensing process, we can show you exactly how to do it and not how to pay crazy consulting fees. We don't charge for the advice for consulting. My incentive is to create a white market so that my distribution platform has a future. You know, like unless I can get my friends in the gray market transitioned, I don't ultimately have a business. So that's why we're giving away these resources. And that's why I'm actually not here tonight, so I'll tell you about it. But if anybody has some questions, just grab that. I'm available. You can get me on all the usual internet pages.
I found us on
myself on the easy account.
So yeah. Twitter, Cannabis Twitter is pretty hot as well. If you guys are on Cannabis Twitter.
I still haven't signed my first tweet yet. Well,
we also
we've
been playing with you so
but yeah, again, I'm pretty Victoria on Wednesday. So I'm actually in Victoria 3 of 5 nights this week. So yeah, but I want to get home tonight because I've got a 2-year-old and a wife and all these other people that I've been away from. So
well, thank Rob for
leaving us. Thank you.
We don't have to leave right away. We need to get out of here.